Do you break into a sweat with even the thought of having company? I'm here to help. After trying just a few of my hosting tips, you'll be more than ready to say, come on over. Welcome to part two of cooking terms for beginner cooks. Now, not just beginner cooks though, also intermediate cooks, because many intermediate cooks also ask these questions if they're used to cooking the same recipes over and over and they want to try something new. So today we are beginning with where all things should begin, and that's cheese. Yeah. Now, sometimes when you're working with cheese, you'll see three different terms. You might see sliced, you might see shredded, or grated. What is the difference? Let me show you. The easiest one is to slice cheese. And if you have a cheese slicer, and this is pretty old school, it makes your slices very, very even. See how nicely that came? Well, this is a hard cheese, so it did break up a little bit, but you can see the back of it. You can also slice it this way. It has a sharp wire that cuts through and then a roller that keeps it straight. So you have a nice slice of cheese. You can just go right to a knife and slice it this way. It will also slice nicely, but what's important is that it ends up being a thicker, more uniform look.
I love a man in uniform.
This is sliced cheese. You can buy cheese at the supermarket that's pre-sliced. There's nothing wrong with that. Even Jimmy and I will do that from time to time. Then you might see that the cheese needs to be shredded. If you have one of these, you might even have a box style one that has four sides, you're going to see a larger and a smaller. The larger size is where you're going to shred. So you take your same cheese, and carefully, because you can get your knuckles on this and whoo, you don't have time to make a run to the emergency room.
Fill these out, sit over there.
You run it down here. You can see it makes little lines, and your cheese ends up looking like this. Really nice. It's not too fine. It's finer than a slice, but it's great for baking, particularly if you were going to have shredded cheese on top of a lasagna and it was going to melt down. This is the thickness that you want. You like it this thick because you wanted to do a slow melt, okay? It comes out through the back and you just get it all on out of there, and it's a beautiful thing. Then if you flip it, you will see these tinier holes. I am going to use the same cheese. Now, a Parmesan is easier to grate than say this, and I think this is a Vermont cheddar or something like that. I'm going to run it through these smaller holes, and it makes a really nice, fine, almost like cheese hair. Cheese hair, woohoo!
We just washed the hair.
And that is to melt quicker, and it's softer to the touch, and you can often just sprinkle this on top of things. It won't land as hard as this on your meal, on your plate. This is a beautiful thing. Now, let me show you Jimmy's favorite thing with cheese, and it is this. You see this in restaurants. In fact, we talked about this in one of our, I think it was a Father's Day episode or gifts for him. And so the cheese is already inside there. It's held down, and then you turn the handle. You have to really press hard, and he's actually better at this than I am. See, failing. It's not coming out. I don't know why. Okay, so you press down on the cheese and then it's refusing to grate. Okay. It's like stubborn cheese. The cheese stands alone.
All by myself.
Here it comes. I didn't give it enough time. Do you see it coming out of the bottom there? It's just not at the level. Jimmy does it and it comes out so easily. He would probably say to me, you need a harder cheese. Okay, you need to trust me on this. If Jimmy were here, you'd get the real demonstration. This is more high tech, clearly, than this. This is my tool. This is his tool. You can kind of see it inside if you wanted to zoom in right here. You can see that the cheese is right there inside. Yeah, for me, I will stick with this kind of shredding. Okay, so that is, or grating, that is the cheese part. There's really no other way that you need to work with cheese. And you can actually buy all these pre-grated, pre-sliced, pre-shredded. However, what both of us will tell you is that the cheese is fresher and better if you do the grating and the shredding yourself. You probably already have one of these. Put it to good use and do it yourself at home because you're gonna be thrilled with the outcome. All right, moving on. Moving on to different kinds of chopping. You might see rough chop, fine chop, julienne. What does that mean? Okay, rough chop means what you think it means. It means you can take something like a carrot, you're also slicing here, and then these aren't really chopped, they're sliced. So then you take your, so what we're gonna do is we're gonna take our knife and we're just going to roughly chop it. I mean, it really is what it says, but it only makes sense after you do it a couple times. And you can see it's not uniform in any way. It's still kind of chunky, but it's chopped in a rough way. That's exactly what it means. Versus a fine chop. Now I'm gonna use the onion. I'm going to just cut off a bit of it here to demonstrate because we don't need a lot of it. So you can see I have some slices of onion and I'm gonna go through and I'm gonna very finely chop it. This is also a bit of a dice in that it's tiny parts. Now, why this matters is if you want to get a crunch in a stew or a salad or something like that, you want more of a rough chop so you could actually feel that in your mouth. You want a dice or a fine chop if you're going to mix this into a meal and you don't want to feel that in your mouth. A lot of people like the flavor of an onion, the taste of an onion, but they don't like the way it feels in their mouth. So the way to get through that is to finely chop. Now you can finely chop this as much as you want. I usually stop about right here because I know that that's gonna cook down, it's gonna boil down or saute down or cook down into very, very small pieces. So fine chop and dice are kind of the same thing. It usually means about the same size of a small chop. You can also do this with this kind of an onion. Now, when I use a scallion, which is what this is, and I slice it, I like to go at an angle. It makes it pretty, and you can see it gives it more texture. Now, if I were going to take this and sprinkle it over a salad, you can see that it's going to come down in pretty good sized pieces. That's a slice. But if I wanted it to be less obvious, I would just go in here and give it a little more of a chop so it's cut up more finely. So remember, when you're talking about a chopping, you're talking about the way it feels in your mouth. At least that's the way that I think of it when I'm chopping. Now, let's say it calls for something to be julienned. Usually when it says that, it's because it has to do with the look of the chop. So we're gonna take a lettuce leaf here. And usually when you julienne, you take something like this and you roll it up, okay? As tight as you think you can. And you start slicing it all rolled up like this. Now, why does that matter? Well, you have these pretty little streamers of something. Now, you wouldn't want to cook down with lettuce ever. You want to be able to maybe put it on the side of a dish. So you want it to look pretty. You might put it over the top of something like a raw onion. No, not that. But we could put it over cheese. I could show you the julienne over cheese where it creates kind of a pretty look. You cannot julienne cheese because it's too firm. Anything that's leafy like this, and I'm trying to think, oh, spices. You can julienne spices. You can roll up the leaf of a parsley and just start cutting through it like this, and you're just making a pretty leafy look. It really is that simple. All right, now let's talk about zesting. There's a lot of confusion for people about zesting, and I get that because it depends on what kind of tools you have. There are some zesting tools, and I have those, and I do use them from time to time, but I really go right back to this. The kinds of things that you would zest would be something that has a very firm skin, like a lemon or an orange or even a lime. Limes are harder to zest because you need the bumpiness. Let's zoom in on this. A lemon or an orange peel is bumpy, so it has to have something that's going to catch in here to make the zest. So what you're doing is you're getting the outside of the skin of your fruit, not the white part, which I'll show you in a minute. You just want the bare outside, which adds a very, very intense flavor to a dish that you're making. So I'm gonna go ahead and zest this lemon by firmly holding it against here. And did you hear that? That kind of grate? What I've done is I've gotten this very outside. You're not doing this back and forth, and I wish you could smell this. Oh, the fragrance.
You can smell it? Oh yeah, I have it. I have a lot of it.
But you're getting down to the white part. You could do two even. You can hear it. It's a lot of resistance. And here's what you get. You get this beautiful little flakes, the orange or the lemon or some sort of citrus fruit that you need a really kick of the flavor. When you need a kick of the fruit flavor, the zest is where you want to go. So you can zest an entire lemon. Just keep going around. Try not to get any white. When you get down to here, that's as far as you can go until you have the amount you need. It may call for a quarter teaspoon, a tiny amount. It may call for a tablespoon. And let me tell you, a tablespoon is a lot of zest. You would probably need one or two of these to get a whole tablespoon. I actually used a recipe recently that called for 2 tablespoons of lemon zest, and I felt like I was zesting forever, but man, was it worth it. Just this last weekend, I used lemon zest over asparagus, roasted asparagus, and it was delicious. So don't be afraid of your zester. Keep your knuckles free from that area. Use the small size and go for it. All right, in our final terminology for this episode in food prep, we're going to talk about the dash and the drizzle. So how much is a dash? Let me demonstrate. Let's say you have salt. And why they say a dash is that it really just needs a little bit. In fact, there's another term, pinch, and we'll do that next. A dash really means this. There, I just dashed a little bit of salt. Sometimes I 2 dash because I think it's awesome. And sometimes I dash over my coffee because it's a chemical reaction and it really does make a difference. Same thing with pepper. You have to be a little more careful with pepper because pepper's stronger. That is a really healthy dash. Okay, what is a drizzle? I'm just gonna use good old olive oil here. When you're gonna drizzle something, and I'll just go ahead and drizzle my vegetables that I have here. You're not dumping oil on it because it would be too much oil. You want to get it close to the lip. So right now it's here. I'm bringing the oil down the neck and I'm gonna start moving because I just want to drizzle a bit of oil. That's it. I don't want a lot of oil. And even then, I might take it and move it around a bit to get my drizzle truly drizzled. So it's not swimming in oil, but it's definitely coating it. And you often will use a drizzle in a topping of a vegetable, either before you put it into the oven or once it comes out, or it could even be with salad items. And in fact, another term that you'll see with that is to toss things. And that's what I just did. I, by hand, tossed all of these beautifully chopped and julienned vegetables in the oil so that it's covering it. It's not a perfect science in any way, and you don't have to use your hand. You can use two forks and really toss it, but you just want to get it worked in. If I wanted to bring some over here and just toss a little bit more, I could toss in some cheese and really make it a nice little salad. See how it's all mixed in together? I have basically stirred it, but I've tossed it with my hand. And that works every time. And now for a bonus term. This is au jus, which is French for with the juice, meaning the juice of the meat that you have been sauteing, the juice the meat releases in the pan when you saute or fry or sear or whatever it is you're doing to prep the meat. You get this beautiful, usually dark liquid juice. When I'm sauteing to put something into the crock pot, I will put the meat in and then I will dump the pan of the au jus right over it. If you don't have time for that, if you're not actually prepping your meat in that way, guess what? There is a packet prepared for you called au jus. There is no shame in using this. I've actually used packets like this in recipes where I did not prep the meat, where I needed the flavor of the salt and the fat, the oil that comes when you get that meat down in that pan. I need that flavor, but I don't have the flavor. I don't have time to create that flavor. So I use the packet, no shame in that. All right, we've created a little bit of a mess here, but that's what you do when you prep food. And that, I hope, helped you in so many ways. All right, this concludes part two, but make sure you check out part three, where I talk about cooking terms that apply strictly to garlic. You're also slicing here, and then these aren't really chopped, they're sliced. So then you take your fork and you go through here, your fork. And I was going to sprinkle, because that's a chemical experience. Also, chemical experience. It's not a chemical LSD experience. I'm not that person. I'm not a hippie. Maybe I'm a hippie. From time to time. Got the hair. All right. That. Why are the endings so hard? I think I just got salt in my eye. Okay, there's salt in your eye. All right, this concludes part two, but make sure you check out. Check. Sorry about your ears, sorry. All right, this concludes part two, which you probably thought was never gonna conclude. No.
Come on over. Now go make someone feel special today.